We seek the immense grace of the Almighty for having granted us this unique and rare opportunity of listening to His divine words. Our humble salutations to the entire Guru Parampara for having made this knowledge available to us. Once again, a very warm welcome to all my dear friends. Okay, now, yesterday we were at verse 27 and Lord Krishna has been continuously telling Arjuna, in all probabilities, from all directions, from all angles, all perspectives, that Arjuna, there is no reason for you to grieve. You are not killing your Pitamaha, you are not killing your revered Guru. If they are supposed to be the nature of the Atman, then they are indestructible. If they are supposed to be the nature of a Jiva, then what dies has to be born again, and what is born has to die again. And if they are of the nature of the body, then in any which case, body has to, one day or the other, go back to the earth. So don't grieve, Arjuna. And now, here and there, you know, in between, he tries to give him some different flavors. He tries to slightly tell him something else, not to tell the same thing again and again. So there, in verse 30, we did 28, okay, 29. Okay, in verse 29, he says, are you all reciting after me? I'll give breaks in between so that after me you all can recite, and then I'll go to the next sentence of the verse. Now this is a verse, if you can see, chapter 2, verse number 29, it has got four sentences. Normally it is two, but here it has four. So the tune of this particular verse changes. It's not in the normal way. आश्चर्यवत् पश्यति कश्चिदेन आश्चर्यवत् ददति ततैव चान्यः आश्चर्यवत् चैनमन्यः शृणोति श्रुत्वाप्येनं वेदन चैव कश्चित्। See here, you all must have noticed, everywhere you are seeing that word ashcharya, ashcharya is coming, you know. Ashcharyavat, it's like a wonder. Pashyati, sees. Kashchit, someone. Vadati, he speaks. Shunoti, hears. And Shrutva, having heard. Na, means does not. Vedam, means he doesn't understand. So here this is actually true about this Bhagavad Gita. So what the Lord is trying to say here is, one who comes to know about this, like as you all are coming to know about this, if somebody is coming to know for the first time, he finds there is something wonder over here, ascharya, wonder. What is this? He's saying something like this is this, indestructible, this is, it never dies, then again it dies, and then again it is born. So all these concepts, you know, theories and concepts, all that is being told over here, just to know about it itself is a wonder. And also the one who comes to listen about it, he may not understand it, huh? He will just only comes to listen about it. He'll also say, this is something wonderful. I have never heard of it. And there are some who come to listen, who come to know. And for the ones like where I am speaking, now I am speaking, you'll also speak to somebody else about this. There also there is an expression of wonder. What a wonderful thing is this. There is something known as a supreme power of this nature. And another dimension, there is something wondrous about this. People who have known and who have tried to know and who have tried to listen, and they have heard also about this, but they don't get to understand this. This is also something wondrous. I try, however hard, I'm not able to understand this. And there is somebody next who is able to understand this. So here, God, having told this, now is also preparing Arjuna. Arjuna, be very careful when you listen. Just don't listen half mind here and half mind somewhere else. Don't do that. Listen very carefully. He tells, you know, Indra, Virochan, all these people had to go to the Satyaloka to Lord Brahma to listen to this. And you are getting it here on this planet Earth. Vamadeva, he was in the womb of his mother. And there he got to listen to these divine words and he got liberated in the womb itself. Jadabharata, the king, he had to take a rebirth again. And he was born as a deer because there was tremendous attachment. That's another story. So he also, in the form of a deer, he listened to this and he also got liberated. So don't take this lightly. You have to be focused. You have to pay attention. And you have to have that Shraddha. So that way he tries to prepare him. Now whatever I am telling you, you listen. And he gives all these expressions. You know, this is like that treasure below the earth. Everybody is walking over it daily. But nobody knows what is there below the earth. It is like that treasure. One needs to know it, understand it. And that can happen only when you pay attention. And then he moves on to the next verse. Please repeat. Dehi nityam avadyoyam. Dehe sarvasya bharata. Tasmat sarvani bhutani. Natvam shochitum arhasi. Natvam shochitum arhasi. See this shochitum arhasi, several places it has come. What does that mean? Do not mourn, do not grieve. Now he gives another perspective over here. Arjuna, what do you think? As I've explained to you earlier, this Atman which is prevailing in all these bodies, not only about your teacher and Pitamaha, all these bodies, they can never be killed, slain. So there is no reason at all for you to grieve about this. Understand that. Take it to your mind straight that you should not be unnecessarily thinking of this, Arjuna. You come from a great lineage, which your lineage has always protected Dharma. It doesn't behold of you to behave like this. So if you take Bhishmacharya and Dronacharya as the self or the Atman, it is indestructible. And if you take them as the Jivatma, also then they die and are born again. So there is nothing that you are losing. It is like change of clothes. If you take them as the body, anyway they are going to die. Hence don't grieve. So likewise, from the from the verse almost 12 to 25, he spoke from the Paramarthika angle. The Paramarthika angle is from the Atman angle. And now 26 and 27, that is from the Jivatma angle. And now verse 28, he says, Vyavaharika, which is basically transactional. They are manifest for some time and then they are again not manifest for some time, and again they are manifest. What is there in a person who has manifested and after he dies, actually you get, ash and bones, which has got calcium, phosphorus, iron, that's all. And if you go to sell that, you will not get more than 200 or 300 rupees for that entire thing, what comes out of a human body after it is burnt. So this is the state. There is nothing in this. Understand your true self. Okay. So then we move to the next verse. Why I insist on chanting is, see, whether you know the meaning or you don't know the meaning of this, this has got its great impact on the mind. Like, you take a medicine. You don't know how it is made, what it is made of. You don't know anything about it. But when you take a medicine, whatever it has to do, if it is a painkiller, it has to kill your pain. It does that job, right? Or it has to cure some portion where there is an infection, it does that job. So in the same way, these shlokas, I have got that immense power because there is the sound vibration. And when you say it yourself, there is an external vibration and an internal vibration which happens. Once a young boy, who is about 8-9 years old, his grandfather used to wake him up every day in the morning at about 5:30 types and tell him, get up, get up. And why? He says, no, you have to chant the Bhagavad Gita. Now this boy, he loved his grandfather. So rubbing his eyes, he used to quickly take a wash and come there and sit with his grandfather. And grandfather used to teach him. They say the verse and he used to repeat after him. And it went on and on and on. Month passed, 2 months passed, 3 months passed, 6 months. Once the grandson, he asks his grandfather, grandfather, what is this? I don't understand one word also. I've been religiously chanting what you're saying, but I don't understand anything. Of what use is this to me? Why are you making me get up so early? I was sleeping so nicely. I had a dream also, he tells his grandfather. So then the grandfather says, listen, the location is the house and about 200 feet away there is a river. So they are staying on the banks of a river. So he tells his grandson, what you do is you take this, you have this twig baskets, cane baskets. So just take that cane basket where in those days they used to have a place where they used to heat water with coal, that charcoal, you know. So for putting that charcoal into that boiler, they had a cane basket. And he says, you take this cane basket, that black in color. He says, you take this, go and fetch some water from the river for me. So this poor boy, he takes the basket, he runs to the river and picks up water and he comes back. While he's coming back, since it's a cane basket, all the water drained away. Then the grandfather says, no, 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 now you try a little more, be a little more quick. Please do it again. So again the grandson runs. Likewise, the boys are full of energy. All kids are full of energy, right? So once, twice, thrice, six times, 10 times, 12 times. Then the same thing is happening. There's no change. The grandfather asks him, you're not able to get any water. What is this? What do I do? By the time I come, everything drips off. But then the grandfather says, did you see one thing, beta, here? When you earlier took this basket to fetch water, it was black in color. Now see, it has become golden white. So this is what exactly it does to your mind and heart. It cleanses your mind and heart as it goes inside. So, whether you understand, you don't understand, meaning you didn't get any water out of this, so it didn't make any sense for doing this, using this basket. But in the process, it got cleaned. So that's what the grandfather narrates. So in the same way, it does a lot good to us. So let's, with devotion, recite wherever possible. We'll keep doing this. Okay. Now, from 31 verse onwards, Lord Krishna brings in the dharma angle, the righteousness angle. Now, Atman over, Jiva over, now he comes on the, we say, no, a dharma lagta hai kya, ab jo kar rahe, is it right what you're doing? So that way, that angle. स्वधर्ममपि चावेक्ष न विकम्पितुमर्हसि धर्म्याद्धियुद्धश्रेयो तत्त्रियस्य न विद्यते. सो हियर ही टेल्स हिम, सी आई हैव सो फार स्पोकन टू यू फ्रॉम द पारमार्थिक एंगल. नाउ भगवान सेज, ही ट्राइज टू रिमूव द फियर ऑफ डेथ टू हिम एंड ही गिव्स बेसिकली, इनिशियली ही गिव्स हिम फ्रॉम द एंगल ऑफ आत्मज्ञान. And he comes the reverse way. I'll now tell you from the dharmic angle. Even if you see from the standpoint of Dharma Arjuna, this shoka, meaning the sorrow, and moha, delusion, which is the wrong understanding, should not be there. For a kshatriya who is raised by the society at a cost for a righteous war, there is nothing higher than this deed. Understand? You know, to maintain an army and to upkeep the army, what is the amount of expenditure which happens to the kingdom? Like in our own case, I think the defense expenditure is the highest in the budget. Almost it goes up to 50%. So when that is the case, when the whole kingdom has spent on you to be protected when the real time comes, and now you are not actually doing your righteous job. Arjuna, this is not right. So from the point of view of Dharma, also it is not right. They have spent money on you and now you have to pay them back. Give them what they want. They have been ruled treacherously by Duryodhana, so now you have to at least live up to their expectations. Now in the next verse, he again goes to Shishtachara. Like Shishtachara mean, we have known the conduct of like the noble Sri Ramachandra, what he was, whatever his mother said, whatever his father said, that was at a different level he had followed. That is the Dharma and the Shishtachara. So then he goes to the, in the next verse he starts explaining from that angle. Now here, this verse, we'll get to understand about, you know, we Sama, Dana, Beda, Danda, we generally talk about this in our usual life. So using those four methods, how Krishna tries to convince Arjuna. So here he says, Arjuna, remember what your mother told you. This is verse 32. She has always raised you, giving you the right values. Right from the time she was born, you know how brave she was. She was always in sorrow, always in difficulties, but she never gave up. Kunti. And you are now talking like this, you are the son of such a great mother. You have got a rare opportunity. Didn't we try all the four methods? Sama. What is Sama? Where we try to resolve any conflict, any difference, or any dispute, misunderstanding, by a decent peace negotiation. We say, no, baith ke baat karenge. Now, you all did that. Whatever way you wanted to, you all had all sorts of peace negotiations with them. They didn't heed. Kauravas didn't heed. So then you said, Sama, Dana. Dana is where you have to let go something. Give away. Dana literally means charity. Give away something so that at least the dispute ends. Out of 100 rupees, if both have to take 50-50, okay, I'm not getting 50, let me get 40, give him 60. Or let me get 35, give him 65. So Lord Krishna himself went and he as a messenger spoke, okay, we are eligible for half the kingdom, but okay, if you can't give half the kingdom, at least give us 5 cities. No, then give us 5 villages. No, then give us 5 houses at least. No. Dana is also ruled out now with in this scenario. Then he says, Beda. Beda is to dissect, meaning to break the opposite party. In whatever way you can, tantra, kutantra, whatever it is, you try to now break their strength. Because now it's leading more towards war. Now 50% of the efforts are over. Now one last effort is left. So their Beda, Kunti goes to Karna, because their main strength was Karna. If you saw in the list of Rati, Maharati, Ati Maharati, Mahamaharati, so only Arjuna and Karna were two Mahamaharatis. Others were all coming in the lower category. So imagine two being on one side, so then that is the end of the war. The other party could never win. So she goes and Krishna tells Kunti, now you go and try to convince Karna. She goes to Karna, says, Karna, I'm so sorry. You are my son, first son, eldest son. When I was a virgin, unmarried, this happened. Lord Durvasa gave me a boon and I just tried it for the heck of trying, and there you were born. And you know, in a society, being the daughter of a king, and all that she tells, and she says, now you come. And after this war, anyway, Pandavas are going to win. So she's trying to break their sentiments. You become the Samrat. So in that way she convinces, and trying to break the alliance, but no. That also did not happen, because Karna is again of a different level altogether. His nishtha, his dedication to his friend was something else. So that the last one was attack, war. So then here Krishna also tries to say, take from the point of view of Shishtachara, Arjuna. Look at your own grandfather Bhishmacharya, what you are talking about. Amba, Ambika and Ambalika, three daughters, and during their Swayamvar, Bhishmacharya went to their kingdom and asked all these three daughters for Vichitravirya. But Amba was already in love with Salva and she disagreed. So eventually Ambika and Ambalika, they got married to Vichitravirya. But then since Salva was killed, so Amba had no other go. Then she comes back to Bhishmacharya and says, now you marry me. Bhishmacharya says, no, I have taken a vow. I have to upkeep my vow. And that is my Shishtachara and that is my Dharma. And then she is a very stubborn lady who had that tremendous willpower, whatever it is. She goes to Parashurama, Bhishma's guru, and she pleads with him. She explains her story. And there Parashurama, some way or the other, he got convinced. And he commands Bhishmacharya to marry Amba. But Bhishmacharya, he does not budge. He says no. And he fights his own guru, Parshurama. And eventually, you know what happened? Because of that Shishtachara, where Dharma was on the side of Bhishmacharya, he could still befriend Parshurama. This is what Arjuna, learn from your grandfather for whom you are grieving so much, no? So this is what is Dharma was there. Now you have to follow your Dharma, isn't it? Of course, in a war does not show who is right, but what is who is left actually. And the gates of heaven are open for you, fully open. Because you have done something with the right conduct, Arjuna. You are fortunate. You have got such an opportunity. Do your duty. Go and give them the answer, right answer. So now Arjuna is still listening. It's going on. He's slowly trying to understand, slowly trying to reconcile with his mind. What is happening now? Yes, what Lord Krishna is saying is seemingly right. And first aspect is he surrenders to Lord Krishna, isn't it? And he says, now I accept you as my guru. You please tell me, I am going to listen to whatever you say. So when that surrender is there, so then that is like the mind is open. So then they move forward. Here, basically in this, you know, verse 34, 35 and 36, in all these three verses, now they basically talk from the worldly perspective. In verse 34, he says, 33, if you डू नॉट फाइट अर्जुना, यू आर कमिटिंग अ बिग मिस्टेक इन टर्म्स ऑफ नॉट डूइंग योर ड्यूटी एंड दैट विल बी अ ट्रेमेंडस लॉस ऑफ रेपुटेशन फॉर यू. प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड दिस. यू नो यू वेर कंसिडर्ड टू बी अ वॉरियर, अ हीरो ऑफ एन एब्सोल्यूट हाइएस्ट लेवल एंड द एंटायर किंगडम, द यूथ, द मिडल एज्ड, एवरीबडी, द ओल्ड, एवरीबडी वेर रेस्पेक्टिंग यू सो मच टू एन एक्सटेंट. लाइक एज वी सी नाउडेज, इफ देर इज एनी सेलिब्रिटी, बी इट इन स्पोर्ट्स और इन मूवीज, यू नो वट एवर हेयर स्टाइल दे कम अप विथ, एवरीबडी यू सी मोस्ट ऑफ द फैंस दे गो चेंज देयर हेयर स्टाइल, दे कम आउट विथ सम न्यू स्टाइल ऑफ ड्रेसिंग, एवरीबडी फॉलोज दैट. इट्स नॉट अबाउट दैट हेयर स्टाइल और अबाउट दैट ड्रेसिंग, दे फील लाइक दे गेट कनेक्टेड टू दैट पर्टिकुलर हीरो ऑफ देयर्स और हु इज देयर आइडियल. दे ट्राई टू बिहेव लाइक दैम. इफ ही इज वेयरिंग अ ब्रेसलेट, देल ऑल्सो वेयर अ ब्रेसलेट. इफ इज वेयरिंग अ चेन और एनीथिंग वॉट दे सी, दे वॉन्ट टू समहाउ गेट कनेक्टेड इन सम वे ऑर द अदर. दैट वॉज योर स्टेट अर्जुना. Now you are behaving like this, coward. And verse 34 he says, imagine the amount of disgust that will come up with in the minds of all the people who have spent money to raise a warrior like you. You may be a king, but money comes from the public eventually, from the praja. In no way you're going to take this. This disrepute, infamy, it's not going to be accepted, Arjuna. Better come out. And next verse he says, you mean to say all the warriors of the opposite army, they will have any respect for you apart from even your own warriors? Even they'll also think, hey, see, that fellow got scared of us, and they'll talk something. Our view rachana, meaning the rananiti, was so great, seeing that Arjuna got scared and he ran away. That way they'll start talking, Arjuna. Don't ever budge a bit now. You have to upkeep your image. See, this is all, you know, imagine ourselves, we are in the middle of our own situations in life. We succumb to this kind of, where we can't do something, we don't want to move ahead. But there we have to muster courage. Whatever it may be at work, it may be at home, it may be at in another situation, in a relationship. Don't give up. This too shall pass. Have that patience. And do your duty. That's the ultimate underlying bottom line, is do your duty. What has to be done as per the righteousness, that is the dharma, you have to do it, whether you like it or you don't like it. See, in all these statements, we have to understand in what way does this apply to us. Otherwise, it will be just like another movie or a story. What we can draw, the takeaway from this particular teachings, and how we can implement in our lives and improve our lives, live a life with more peace, more joy, and more fulfillment and prosperity. So we got the various angles of what all Arjuna is dejected, Arjuna's wrong understanding, Krishna is telling him from various angles. Now there he is a king, there is a war, he is a warrior, this is the situation. But now we have to analyze from our angle to make our life meaningful. That is the central purpose and central teaching what we need to get from here. So in whatever situation we are, you please analyze and try to draw whatever best you can from these particular sayings of the Lord. That will make a tremendous amount of difference in your life. Apart from, I'm talking the Atmajnana. Atmajnana will do what it has to do. There is no doubt about it. But apart from that, for our worldly life, this is something which we need to pay attention and everywhere try to relate. Okay, if I do this way, I need to muster. If you're feeling weak on any situation, muster courage. If you feel that you're angry in any situation, not able to understand, calm your mind, bring in some patience, and think what is right, what is wrong. Not what you like and what you don't like. What is right and what is wrong. If you can't understand, talk to somebody who is very close to you, a well-wisher, and understand. Because sometimes we can't see our back. You will always feel you are right. That is human nature. So, likewise, he tells him. And then he goes on, he says, Arjuna, even if you die, Arjuna, you will go to heaven. You will win heaven for sure. Even if you die, meaning you lose. And if you are able to win, Arjuna, you become the lord of this universe, Samrat. Understand what a great position you will get in life. So, win-win situation. Either you lose or you win. This is what you are going to get over here. Don't heed to this kind of a loss of courage, cowardness. Get up. And then he finally in verse 38 he says, Sukha dukhe same kritva labha laubhav jaya jayo tato yudhyaya yudhyasva naivam papam avapshasi. Arjuna, victory and loss, this is a part of life. Here somewhere you gain, somewhere you lose, somewhere you win. Somewhere there is trouble, somewhere there is a smooth ride. That's a part of life. Ignore it. You can't have, all the time you can't have victory at your door. If you are enjoying happiness, be aware that sorrow is at the door waiting for you. Don't be too overjoyed. And if you are experiencing sorrow, don't be drowned in sorrow, because joy is already at the door waiting. It wants to come. So they keep coming and going. As you see day and night, as you see dawn and dusk, that is nature. Now, from verse 12 to 37, Lord went on giving his teachings about recouping Arjuna from the Atman angle, from the Dharma angle, Jivatma angle, Shishtachara angle, worldly angle. He gave all this knowledge to him. Now here in this Sankhya Yoga itself, suddenly he brings in Karma Yoga. So from 39 verse onwards, we have Karma Yoga here till 53. And after that, 55 onwards, where 54 is Arjuna's question, then 55 onwards till the end of this chapter, it is all about the qualities of a Sthitapragna, that is up to 72. So this is how Sankhya Yoga will eventually end. So now 39 to 53 are giving an overall feel of Karma Yoga. Extremely useful chapter for us, because the most important thing what we do in our life is action. And how to gain from an action, like you're converting a liability into an asset. In other words, how you can convert a loan into a deposit. So how you can do action to gain out of that action to the utmost manner. So he gives a very unique formula here. So that is what we need to get from these kind of treasures. I didn't know this, that this will happen to me if I do it in this way. The same action, he's not saying do something else. The same action what we are doing on a daily basis, how we can dedicate to the Lord and make the utmost of it in terms of refining our souls. So we'll take this up tomorrow.